The MOME Architecture Institute's public lecture series welcomes prominent Hungarian and international architects, designers, and thinkers to present and discuss their work within the built environment. And we hope that this event and becomes a platform for interdisciplinary discussion, exchange between students, professionals, public, guests, etc., discussing about architecture and the built environment here in Hungary. And so I'm very proud today to present the second lecturer of this semester, who is our featured alumni, Csilla Csabai, who is finished here at MOME Architecture Institute before. She can tell you more about that. And so just a quick word, Csilla lives and works in Perth, Australia, where she's a senior interior designer, the studio practice manager, and Woods Bagot's global technical leader for documentation and specification. She received her qualification here at MoMA and built her understanding on the history of craftsmanship and detailing exhibited in complex European architecture and interior design. And I will hand over to Csilla. Thank you very much for being here. And I hope at the end of the presentation, as usual, we can have a nice discussion. And so everyone, keep your questions. And of course, she'll be presenting in English, but of course we'll understand and we can have a discussion in Hungarian as well, if you're more. Yeah. So thank you very much. And thank you everyone for being here.
Thank you very much, and thank you for accepting me here for tonight. And good evening for whoever made the time to come. I have quite a few ex-classmates here, so it's a reunion as well. So, I would like to take this opportunity to talk about my passion, drawing. My name is Csilla Csabai, and as Zoltán said, I am a senior interior designer for Woods Bagot's Perth studio, and I am also a practice manager for the studio, involving all the quality and associated problems which we have to deal with. And I am a leader on specifications for the entire Woods Bagot global team. I am from the year of the Predator. If anyone can guess what year that was, that's when I finished here with among many others. Hang on. Okay, it's working. So, Woods Bagot is an international architectural and interior design firm with 150 years of history. We operate from 17 studios worldwide and employ over 1,100 talented professionals who have tackled global opportunities. I am from the eastern side, western side of Australia, from the loneliest capital in the world. We work in 11 key sectors, delivering award-winning projects, one of which is the ABN headquarters, shown here with myself modeling. We have won multiple international awards on the corporate space large, like the IIDA International Interior Design Association Global Excellence Award, the FX International Interior Design Award, to name a few. None of these awards would have been possible without the documentation or talented design team has submitted from the concept. Sorry, trying to figure how the mouse works. From the first concept sketch to the final constructual drawings. This presentation is focusing on the act of drawing, why we draw, when it has started, how it has developed. I might gloss over exact dates and proper chronological orders, we forget those anyway, to highlight certain eras in history or draw your attention to a detail. At some stage, we believe our idea is the only one. No one has ever done anything similar before, and it is unique to the area we live in. The process of ideation started millennia ago and will continue into the future. While many past cultures developed their identity through history, they could only process it into the next generation or to leave a record behind through oral history. The expectation and examples we find today originate from the art forms, sculptures, carvings, drawings. With the development of the first conquering empires, the need has arisen to keep standards, follow trends, or just keep things consistent throughout the realm. Let us explore what happened before today. I call myself obsessed with drawing and technical documentation. I just love it. I actually find my high school technical drawing books yesterday at home, to a surprise of mine, and I'm delighted to show it is exactly what we are doing today. Design. We tend to think about design as something recently discovered. Everything we have today, cars, computers, smartphones, fashion shoes, are the result of many thousands of years of discovery. How do we convey the design? We provide an auditory description and emphasize it with drawn pictograms, sketches, or images. What do we need to convey? We need to explain the concept, the desired effect, look, innovation, uniqueness, and the possibility of turning the idea into reality. It could respond to a brief, ideation, description, or we are just drawing for fun. What is drafting? Lines put together in a descriptive way to express an idea, illustrate possibilities, show details, or convey the mathematics and science to turn the designer's idea and the drafter's work into reality. When you observe children, you will see that as soon as they are able to hold an instrument, which could leave a mark, they draw. It is a basic instinct. They show us what they have seen, observed, unbeknown to us. I'm positive that my daughter and her friend never seen the inside of a submarine, yet, as you can see, they gave us a very close replica. The ability to express yourself via drawing partly diminishes around the age of 10, when oral vocabulary and expression is becoming more prominent. We express ourselves more via words. Many people stop drawing at this stage, and when they return to it years, decades later, they haven't shown any more development. They stay at that stage. Without practice, drawing is not evolving. Today, this skill, drafting, drawing, needs to be encouraged and practiced, maintaining the pictorial fluency of communication. Why we draw? It makes communication easier, allows you to bring your ideas to life, boosts creative thinking, explains things words cannot, enhances conversation, relaxes the mind. It is a universal language. Before the hominids learned to communicate with sound, they have used markings, pictorial in nature, representative of the world around them. Drawing is the simplest form of communication. We can understand each other without the exchange of words, being present, or through the ages. Nearly everything around us started out as a sketch. Drawing is manifested in different ways for different disciplines, and it could not engage our visual or cognitive systems simultaneously. When you think about drafting or drawing, most of you will be thinking about architectural drawings. But there are more than 100 disciplines which uses drafting to impart ideas, patterns, scopes, templates, etc. A well-executed drawing can transfer the idea even when it is not showing the finished project. Just pay attention to the color scheme for the racing team delivered on a black and white drawing. This is the original, no color. The central image is the first image of Australia. Just for the theme, and of course, Balaton Lake, where I am from. These ideas, design can be conveyed by a variety of means and materials to provide a visual cue. Drafting is one of the oldest professions and means of communication. It is like a written language, static and unmoving. Some representations are challenging our knowledge, like the anatomically correct arteries and veins drawn on a shape, where the human form is seen as idolatry and it's used, it's encouraged. It's an Islamic drawing. They do not use human form in the architecture or any descriptions. Here it is. And of course, one of the earliest motorcycle patterns. If some people know me, I ride motorbikes. So I had to have one in. William Blake, English poet, painter, and printmaker, has written it in The Marriage of Heaven and Hell. What is now proved once only imagine. Why we draw? It is the simplest and most effective way of communication. Drawing is a really important way of observing the world really, really closely. Rebecca Chamberlain, psychologist, Goldsmith University, London. That's the image for Google logo with the detailed descriptions. The earliest Times Roman letter and who it actually should look like. And Spitfire cockpit drawing from 1942. Antiquity. I have the argument with many students. I teach at Curtin University at Perth as well, when they're asking, why do we have to do this again? We have done this, I don't want to draw it. I'm trying to explain it's nothing new. We are not doing it because it has been done before. We are doing it because this is the simplest communication of a certain idea. It is developed throughout centuries, millennia, and it is the easiest way to make people understand. When did it start? It might surprise many, but it has started BC, before computers. It is narrating the way we live or wish to live. The earliest drawings were found on cave walls, utilizing the only available instruments, their own hands and the soil around. This cave drawing depicts the contact between the Aboriginal people and the European settlers, and it can be found in the Kakadu National Park in Western Australia. People used animal hides, vellum, papyrus, rice paper, silk, clay, plaster, or wax tablets. Practically anything you could leave a mark on. The earliest architectural drawing encountered, which we would associate with architecture, dated to circa 2200 BCE. It is on the lap of the statue of Gudea, ruler of Lagash. It is a floor plan of our temple with measured plan, clearly identifiable walls and openings. That one. It might surprise many. We are talking about 2200 BCE. We are in 2200 BCE. You can see the orthogonal projection of a measured plan of a temple with clearly identifiable walls and opening. It has been carved into diorite, one of the highly treasured materials of the time. The sixth Babylonian king, Hammurabi, enacted a code in circa 1800 BCE. Amongst its 282 laws are a few which deals with the legality and the liability of a builder for a house that collapses. It is the earliest known standard for a building code. And in the center, it's a complaint from a client. You have delivered me shitty copper. Why do you do that? Antiquity. It's not just one part of the world. We are here in Europe, we think about Europe. No, it has developed Egypt, Asia, Americas, and many other parts of the world. Here are some from Egypt and Africa. Egyptians have used papyrus, plastered and painted wood tablets or wax tablets to convey detailed illustrations of proceedings, garden designs, and celebrations, or to keep records. There is also the first identifiable records of teaching aids and corrected learning material. That's the center image. You can see the teachers that correction on the students' work. These artifacts were the first records showing the means to keep the design standardized and at the reign of each of the monarchs. It allowed the stonemasons and architects of the ages to build the same or similar structures in Lower or Upper Egypt. In all profession, the details define architecture. We observe scale, light, shadow, and form. We combine materials through detailing to control the environment, to create stability, to control the aesthetics. A project can be formally or spatially inspiring, but if it isn't detailed properly, things can literally fall apart at the seams. Eric Baldwin, architectural author. Similar expertise was used over millennia and surprisingly evolved at the same rate in various parts of the known world. The drawings we have access to today are mainly based on orthogonal projection, expressing the understanding of scale and the similar interpretation of openings and wall structures. It was almost revolutionary when the first section has been discovered in Abu Hamid el-Garnati's Tawer journal, the long section of the Lighthouse of Alexandria. This is one of the earliest records you can find about the section. Or look at this house drawings from the Roman Empire. Not much different to what we are producing today. We reach to the oriental areas, Asia, India, Korea, China, and Japan. Very similar representations in each area. Archaeological finds prove that the evolution of tools and the physical recording material were developed at the same pace. Asian oriental structures and cultures use similar demetric projection in their art. The Chinese revolutionized papermaking in the 8th century in Xuancheng and invented rice paper. It was industrialized during the Manchu Qing dynasty and used worldwide until the 19th century. The Chinese papermaking technique crossed over to the Middle East and then to Europe via trade along the Silk Route. Combined with the Arabics, mathematics, and astrology, it established Europe's architectural sciences. The good example you have seen on the previous slide was the Longhouse of Alexandria. We are crossing over to the Americas. We established earlier that the tools and means of using drawings have developed at a similar speed. However, artifacts from the ancient Americas mainly consist of architectural models or the illustration of furnishings, like in this vase from Mexico. The use of three-dimensional objects provides us with tangible examples of houses, shrines, courtyards, temples, depicted in breathtaking detail from the Mayas, Aztecs, Recuay, and Nayarit cultures, starting from the first millennium BCE. This form the only records on civilizations whose structures and costumes are mostly vanished. I find that temple is just exquisite. The later North American indigenous cultures, due to their nomadic lifestyle, did not establish permanent structures. Their recorded language was based on knot coding, quipu, which did not allow for pictographic imaging. Decorations used on their temporary structures were based on hunting scenes, stars, animals, and the world around. Almost the earliest depiction of a house is found on the Canandaigua Treaty Bell, commissioned by George Washington. The longhouse depicting the cape, the two figures that's up there, next to the longhouse depicting the keepers of the eastern door, the Mohawks, and the keeper of the western door, Seneca, along with the 13 state representatives. The transfer of European and Eastern cultural influences began with the discovery of the Americas in 1492. As you have realized, they started to build immediately the same mansions and houses what was common in the Spanish Empire and those states. Sorry, some of the images are difficult to see, but you see the carved in line work on that one, which is a high-level window from a church. Artifacts before the common and from the common area are few and far between. Those we have access to today are part of some form of structure or left behind in tombs. The rest probably were too fragile to survive. In medieval Europe, papyrus, rice paper, or vellum were not available to the commoners or the illiterate. Gifted artisans and masons used plaster or wax tablets to calculate angles or draw ideas and detailed technical drawings. You need to search hard to find examples of their work today. The medieval masons used materials available to them during construction to communicate architectural values to the clients and establish and illustrate design principles. Not everyone is a designer, and drawings are the simplest communication tools. This practice has become the means to plan proceedings, get funding, approvals, and to translate the abstract into reality. The master mason's true skill was the knowledge of geometry, the rules of proportion, the golden ratio, and the Fibonacci number influenced the design of the great buildings during this period. I find it very interesting. That is a wax tablet from Egypt. We are talking about 2500 BCE, and we still have this today. Once the client and master builder had agreed on the design, setting out began. Elements of the building were described on polished plaster floors and full-scale timber models were built. This left us with tangible artifacts and tactile surfaces to appreciate once we noticed them. This was a recent discovery, in 1968, when they realized the random lines in in their your piece there are actually the descriptions of the high-level windows. When you walk the church door, you don't realize these lights that actually has not something to do with construction. Perhaps the most noteworthy graffiti in the church of Ashwell is what believed to be the image of the old St. Paul's Cathedral. It's up there. It's an elevation, which sadly burned down during the Great Fire of London. It is an extremely rare to find such detailed depictions of medieval buildings, making this little bit of outsider art a true archaeological treasure. It's a medieval graffiti. Those churches are actually full of them. Although papermaking was a trade secret during the 14th to the 19th century and was an expensive commodity, it became more accessible during the Renaissance era when artists made detailed sketches of classical buildings they imagined. In those days, the rendering did not include measurements and the convention for detailed plans had not yet been defined. Builders and masons were expected to work out details by following the illustrations. Villa de Bonnecourt booklet is more of a recording of already existing buildings than new construction drawings or plans, but it is a good record on the medieval building practices and era. Projection. Established convention determine which points of an object are projected. In conventional practice, a set of drawings consists of three views: plan, front elevation, side elevation, unless, of course, the object is essentially a flat form. Additional views are used to provide further definition to eliminate ambiguities or clarify added details. This can be included as required. Although working and construction drawings are based on orthographic projections, the other pictorial representations, such as perspective, helps illustrating the project in a more realistic setting. The development of the perspective began around the 5th century BCE in ancient Greece, creating an illusion of depth. Early Roman painters, while they demonstrate the understanding of the one-point perspective, they not always follow it through in their art. You can see it's several points pointing to a one-point perspective. The knowledge was lost until the era of the Duecento and Cinquecento formally reintroduced it as a teaching perspective. The true geometrically based perspective birthplace is the Italian Renaissance. Filippo Brunelleschi, the founding father of the Italian Renaissance, introduced the linear perspective, one-point perspective, like that, and used a camera obscura to copy architectural details from Roman ruins. He's also the forefather of the modern blueprint. Andrea Pozzo was an Italian Baroque painter who is most famous for his frescoes demonstrating his illusory perspectives. His published work of the Perspectiva Pictorum et Architectum is republished today. It is one of the earliest manuals on perspective for artists and architects. Its elegant illustrations can be assembled into three-dimensional spaces in the central image. In Oriental art, spatial depth was attained via overlap or planar perspective. The distance between the planes was accentuated by detail and tone, creating an aerial perspective in sceneries. Sorry, I didn't put any picture on that. Architectural representations are commonly used parallel, oblique, or dimetric perspective, eliminating the need for vanishing points. Everything just points to somewhere. orthographic projection, a three-dimensional object's representation in two dimensions, was invented during the Industrial Revolution period, 1750 to 1850, by Gaspard Monge, a French mathematician. It is described in his book, Geometry Descriptive. His concept not only spread in the Western civilization, but it was introduced in China during the same period. The left-hand image, the very earliest farm floor plan in Europe. It is on vellum, it's very fragile. Ninth century. And the second one in the center is from the first century. Illustrating not just the building, but the intervals. Hot water, cold water. So think about it, you are talking to your consultants, please give me hydraulic drawings. It's nothing new. Drafting techniques. Technical drawing is a process in which a person creates a detailed illustration of an item. Perhaps the most well-known type of technical drawing is the floor plan, which shows the exact dimensions of a building or other planned construction project. As buildings become more complex, the details had to be incorporated into the drawings to show finer details and solve engineering problems, thus providing solutions before construction could begin. Between the 15th and 17th centuries, we saw the emergence of technical drawings. As engineering processes and buildings become more complex and included other disciplines other than architecture, it has become increasingly important that drawings are duplicated. The time of a skilled draft person is expensive. Other methods were sought. Cyanotype or blueprinting was invented in the USA in 1842. It is a process of shining light through a translucent material to create a duplicate, the duplicate being the blueprint. In 1895, the Van Dyck brown printing was patented in Germany. And we had to wait until 1940 when the white prints were introduced. One of my favorite examples is the connector plate from the Sydney Harbour Bridge. That's on the top. Companies researched and developed drafting gates, like the rotary isograph pens or the letterset dry transfer sheets. Some of us, ancient people, are still familiar with these. In modern days, drafting is a skill translating the design concept into a pictorial representation of a final product. The several stages of the development require the determination of fits, clearances, manufacturing feasibility, and the preparation of the final drawings. As you can see on screen, manual drafting is an essential skill showcased by samples from some famous name. The most boring sliding door details from Le Corbusier, or a chair pattern drawing from Charles Ames. In the modern age, drawings were still created on the drafting boards using the famous T-squares and sliding parallels. Before drawing became the fruit of the computer programs aided drafting evolution. This development allows for the retention of memory, precision, uniform recreation, and reproduction. A skilled draftsman or designer is still required to control these programs or processes. That is a comparison between hand-drawn and computer-created drawing. The samples shown here are from buildings which were either created on a CAD program or the available manual documentation were digitalized. Bergerac is created on CAD. recreated from the original hand drawings. These images show the best juxtaposition between the beginning of the computer-assisted design revolution and the current state. The sketchpad was at the forefront of modern technology, allowing for analog data input collaboration via telephone and reproduction of these inputs. It's the forefather of the modern iPad, and who knows where we are going from there today. While on the other hand, there is the augmented interactive design, allowing for three-dimensional experience in real time. In reality, we are designing and working somewhere between, where with the combination and application of different programs, we can deliver data-driven parametric designs. You can walk around that beautiful motorbike. Shamri, South Australia, Australian Health and Medical Research Institute in Adelaide, is by Woods Bagot, was almost the first introductory project in next-level design application where data-driven parametric design is used with programs like Grasshopper, Ecotect, Ladybug, and Honeybee. The Adelaide and Melbourne and New York studios collaborated to come up with solutions to the design intent and help in the geometric rationalization, moving away from hard edges and establishing radial curvatures. These programs help to create comparable and consistent geometries which can be repeated. These analyses helped panelization, view location, and solar exposure to establish environmental control strategies underlining the design. It is also a world award-winning project. The following slides are a short case study of one of our winning competition entries against Zaha Hadid and Com Pedersen Fox Architecture. My apologies, but my insider knowledge is limited, being part of the team for a very limited time. This project is the Omniet Towers in Dubai. It was proposed in a new business district with only a few existing buildings around. While Perth projects are closer to human scale and in context can relate to local history, materiality, and the local population, this new project in Dubai is of massive scale, driven by economic factors from 2016. The collaboration between the local Dubai team and the Perth studio have to establish a new context for this new financial district. To start this, the team established a concept scope based on the historical Islamic geometric shapes, deriving further inspiration from fashion design. It clearly defines silhouettes, plates, and the elegance of movement. The shifting economic forces during the design phase meant the team needed to accommodate to rapidly evolving client requirements. Once the forms and locality limitations were established, the massaging of the design began. The concave and convex shelves eventually took shape. Due to the mixed-use nature of the project, hotel, offices, apartments, cultural and civic spaces, retail and car parking, loading areas, the towers were constantly re-evaluated to create the required balance between the different strict municipality dictates and the client wishes. Documenting the ever-changing conditions, including measured NLA, core strategies, transfer floor locations, and apartment typologies, required the development of new and advanced software functionality to align the geometry with the marketing requirements. These incredible hand-drawn sketches from my colleague helped to guide the design intent and form the base of the parametric exterior wall model. Woods Bagot, with the help of Brian Ringley, Boston Dynamics, wrote scripts in the Rhinoceros Grasshopper app to allow the designers to manipulate forms, change floor plates, heights, the shape of the veil, and pinch points with updating the floor plates. A program had to change this instantaneously. You wrote the input and the plates have changed. The area calculations expander in the OmniEd concept design app allows for the real-time calculation and visualization of total areas per building, as well as area subtotals per floor. These scripts and programs help the team to explore any client request. For example, what would be the effect if there is less hotel, more residential area, or the office capacity increases? Again, constant change. The facade was also extensively explored to cater for sun shading, solar access, environmental design requirements, and of course, the cost differences between the various manufacturing processes. Level elevations were used to establish the tower curtain wall stack, and it was controlled from an Excel workbook. This data was connected to a parametric exterior wall model, which helped to explore the deflection points, modularity, rationalization, and the cost effectiveness of the cold bend process. If you remember, this is convex and concave facade. Every door window is different size, shape. This project brought the bodies and canyons of the area into the cityscape, highlighting the need of a multi-talented global team who were capable of hand sketching and script writing to deliver an outstanding result. Architecture cannot divorce itself from drawing. No matter how impressive the technology gets, drawings are not just end products. They are part of the thought process of architectural design. Drawings express the interaction of all minds, eyes, and hands. Michael Graves, this quote from Michael Graves elegantly summarizes the need for drawing, even in today's advanced technological society. It is essential that you develop and hone your drawing skills to create your own signature style. You never know when you will need to create or draw a sketch in front of your most important client. One of these development sketches is from our Auckland studio by Alexis Fox. Clearly demonstrates the idea of a new skyscraper drawn during the meeting with the client. Some designers and architects are born with natural ability and excellent drafting skills to be able to convey their design. Others must develop their own style through hard work and rigorous exercise to get close to their perceived perfection. I believe you are familiar with the images and final architectural marvels on the following slides, and they will not need further introduction. Again, hand drawing is essential. Most wonders start with just a simple scribble. These original sketches allow us to experience the birth of an idea, a vision, from the mind of a designer. Sometimes, it only takes a few simple lines to engage and entrance your audience and bring them on board. Without a visual design translation, many fundamental concepts would remain ungraspable by most. Paolo Antonelli, Design of the Elastic Mind. The team worked hard on that sketch to make it into that building. There is a fine line. Sometimes we provide too much information and the client loses the idea. Make sure you work with your client, balance their needs and your design aspirations. By focusing on the pretty pictures, you might lose the intelligence of the design. These are samples of too much. I don't know what you want. I see everything at once. You need to simplify. Drawing is the simplest and most effective way that any human can get another human to see and understand the ideas that are in their head. Jonathan Mears, director of the Product Design Department, University of Kentucky, College of Design. Work with your team and establish a close collaboration between the client, project management, consulting team, designers, and drafters to deliver perfection. And of course, today we do not talk about Bruno. I hope you have seen Encanto. The obvious decisions needed before the drafting can begin in earnest. Metric or imperial, what's on the drawing, limitations and standards, line thicknesses, style, symbols, and of course, mistakes originating from limited experience, miscommunication, misunderstanding, or lack of knowledge. All of which can be eliminated by practicing. Fifth element, concept, Star Wars. And your job is to get your audience to care about your obsession. I believe this quote from Martin Scorsese eloquently summarizes of my intention for this presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you. You will find my research references and summary of wood spaghetti history on the following two slides, if you are interested. Thank you very much.
Some references? Yes. Hello.
Oh, come.
Yes. Thank you very much for your interesting presentation, kind of cross-section through all of the different processes from, very interesting. Does anyone have any questions? Now's the time. English or in Hungarian as well, of course, is welcome. Maybe I can start with one question or So I think it's really interesting connecting your history finishing here in MOME with obviously kind of a grounding in this kind of craftsmanship and drawing and linking to working on some of the most innovative projects in the world in a whole nother corner of the world for more than 20 years.
It's quite challenging.
Yeah. Maybe you can talk a little bit on the connection from what you do in a kind of day-to-day basis and how you've built your career in the last two decades,
yeah,
and to kind of these fundamentals of design.
Thank you. Practically, it's as you know personally yourself, many of you who have worked on various firms on projects, of course you have to prove yourself every single time you change a firm. Your resume looks fantastic, everything what they read in there sounds great, can you do it? You have to prove yourself. So my strength is, of course, not design in a way of coming up with a huge concept, in the design of the way of how can you build this project. So I have proven time and time again, I didn't understand how things come together, or you build it, or you put it together. And I also look after, we call it DDA, disability design access, which I recommend the PDA sign on the toilet is not right. So every project is actually calls on me to assess, do we have the right clearances? Do we have the right space? Is it enough? Do we have room enough around tables, chairs, meeting rooms, corridor is wide enough, a door opening the right way? I deal with the boring stuff. Many people who are in this institute wants to be the next Zahavi or I do not know who is the most famous of the moment in that respect. And that's it is for aspiration. That's where we want to be and that's where we want to be. You will fall into your niche where you are really comfortable, where you are delivering your own excellence. And if it's falling into technical design, be that part of the excellence. I lead projects to up to 100 million Australian dollars. That's my limit on project. I deliver it at one site. I tell the builder, don't do that, do that, can be resolved. I took my studio chair along with me to one of the site visits, and when we came back, we said, damn, you know what you want. Yes, I know, because I go into that detail, I am interested for their work, and I negotiate between the client or firm and the builder. Every project is standing on three legs. Sometimes you give in to the client, yes, you can have that. Sometimes you give to the builder, okay, let's build it your way. It changes the detail, but it's better. Sometimes I'm standing firm, no, this is the design, this is what I want. But that is when you learn to work with your clients. I'm hopelessly shitty at the beginning of any project. Concept and sound vision, it's not me. Don't ask me, damn, leave me alone. But if you ask me to ask the client, can I have an extra 100,000 because we need to do this, when we are on site, I can do that. So it is a niche you fall into. None of us born designers. We are learning, we are developing. I learn new things every single day. And at the beginning, young graduate, not even graduate, hasn't finished university yet, has taught me how to organize a good set of construction documentation. He hasn't finished yet. And I'm standing there with nearly 50 years experience and I'm looking, damn, this is looking good, I want to do this, and how you do it. You learn everything, you need to listen and watch what others do, and of course, see through what's best, what suits you, and it's no shame in adopting someone who's doing something better. Take it on board, embrace it. On the other hand, help others to reach that one. I also mentor high school students in their career path. I mentor colleagues for the Design Institute of Australia, and I mentor my colleagues. Pass on your knowledge. You have learned things. That's where the dealing with mistakes comes in. I have learned it. I have done this. Let's do better. Can we deliver it that way? So that's me.
Thank you. So anyone else like to ask something or raise a conversation point? I think for students as well might be interested in this, starting in MoMA and having a kind of diverse experience. It's really interesting. And I think also for those today who are focused kind of on this, in the profession, both from the manual approach to the digital, I think it's a really interesting to kind of superpose both of these ways of creating and that you each side balances on the other.
As you said, it started from when student came to me, why do I have to do this? I'm so worried, I can do better. It's not just because it's being done, it's because it's an established understanding of the conventional means, how to build it. So if you understand the history, where it is coming from, makes your life easier. You don't argue about it because it has been done, oh, big deal. So there's nothing new about it. And it, I got more and more involved into that one. And was, I have to tell these guys off. And I actually run this presentation at Curtin University in Perth, and I just passed it on to one of my old colleagues, 15 years older than us, so I think it's old. And he said, wow, I actually learned new things I did not know before. Because just collecting the dots from various areas and various locations, you realize is we are living the same. We are trying to create something, and we are trying to create that, whatever it might be, for someone in Asia to understand, someone in France to understand, someone in South Africa to understand. So we are trying to talk a common language.
Yeah. Magyarul is lehet. If not, then I propose let's give Csilla another round of applause for being here, and we can have a drink outside and finish the evening. So thank you very much for coming, and thank you all for being here, and we can talk.